This is the last image Yardley Love's family and friends have of her.
Probably like 7 o'clock in the morning or something.
Yeah. And then I was on the news like an hour later.
News that her friend was murdered, taken, police say, by the hands of this man, George Hughley. And while Love may be gone, friends say her memory will always live on.
I talk like she's still here, you know, like how we talk about how she was and just everything.
Now they focus on these images, pictures of Yards, as they called her, a loyal friend.
She was very bubbly, fun-loving.
A practical jokester.
She was full of jokes. She always had something up her sleeve.
And someone who couldn't carry a tune.
She honestly had the worst singing voice that you've ever heard.
That voice was silenced May 3rd, 2010, inside her apartment on 14th Street. Love was found by her roommate face down on her bed in a pool of blood. Hughley admitted to police that he kicked his foot through her door, got into an argument, and shook Love, and her head repeatedly hit the wall. Love grew up in the Baltimore suburb of Cockeysville, Maryland, living in a house along a winding road removed from all the hustle and bustle. With her father, John, passing in 2003, Love is survived by her mother, Sharon, and her sister, Lexi. Love attended both middle school and high school here at Notre Dame Prep in Towson, Maryland. Here she studied hard, played lacrosse, and kept a close circle of friends.
A contributor in every way imaginable, every positive way there was. She's a great athlete and a great team player.
Love started classes at the University of Virginia in 2006. On the lacrosse field, the rising star sported the number one jersey, starting in 9 games in her final season. Her jersey has been retired.
We keep Yardley in our hearts and in our minds, and the Love family certainly right there with her.
Even in death, her memory lives on. Through the One Love Foundation, the mission to bring out the goodness in students, and through this circle of friends, a circle now incomplete.
We're so fortunate to have each other, and we were so fortunate to have Yardley in our lives, and she forever changed all of us.
Born into a successful family, blessed as an athlete, accepted as a student into the University of Virginia, George Hughley seemed to have it all. That is, until May 3rd, 2010. That's when Charlottesville police say something went wrong inside this apartment on 14th Street, and Hughley killed his ex-girlfriend, Yardley Love.
Probable cause existed for us to take him into custody and obtain warrants for his arrest.
Now Hughley's facing 6 felony charges, including first-degree murder. Hughley admitted to police that he kicked his foot through Love's door, got into an argument, and shook Love, and her head repeatedly hit the wall. Love was found by her roommate face down on her bed in a pool of blood.
This case is a tragedy, but not about an intentional criminal act.
This is not Hughley's first run-in with the law. In fact, he's been arrested at least 2 other times. In Florida in 2007 for possession of alcohol by a minor, and in Lexington in 2008 for being drunk in public and resisting arrest.
He became more aggressive, more physical toward me, started calling me several other terms that I'm not going to state now.
Officer R.L. Moss with the Lexington Police Department had to use a taser on Hughley.
Surprised that he was involved in another type of incident involving physical violence, no. An incident to this extent, yes.
And Florida authorities say that physical violence continued at home. An intoxicated Hughley had to be rescued off the shore of the family's million-dollar vacation home. Investigators say he and his father got into a heated argument on a yacht. It ended with Hughley jumping overboard. George Hughley was born in Washington, D.C. He grew up in this wealthy suburb of Chevy Chase, living with his mother, Martha Murphy, and father, George Hughley IV. His family operates a major building supply company in D.C., founded in 1912. Hughley was an all-star lacrosse player here at Landon School in Bethesda, Maryland. Friends say he was always upbeat, charming, and they are shocked that he's been charged with first-degree murder.
The George Hughley I know growing up, the George Hughley that played in my backyard with me every single day, was not capable of doing something like this.
And on this day, Hughley's UVA-clad Tahoe police once searched, sits at his Maryland home, while the once playful child, star lacrosse player, and now accused murderer, sits in a jail cell awaiting his fate. A new forensic report in the George Hughley case shows that of 17 pieces of evidence tested for blood, clothing, a shower curtain, red-stained swabs from a bathtub, only one came back positive, and the blood didn't belong to Hughley or the woman he's accused of killing, Yardley Love.
The Commonwealth has a duty to turn over favorable lab reports favorable to the defense, as well as the reports that they intend to use that are unfavorable to the defense.
Hughley's defense team has also requested a copy of all emails between Love and Hughley's UVA accounts that went to the suspect from January 1st, 2010 until Love's death. Witnesses for the two-week February jury trial are also being subpoenaed. NBC 29 has learned that they include doctors, former UVA tennis players, and current UVA students. There will also be an unexpected hearing before the trial. Hughley's defense team has filed four new motions to be heard on Friday. They deal with sentencing testimony, media plan reconsideration, graphic photos shown to the potential jury pool, and individual questioning of potential jurors.
Maybe you want to ask jurors, you know, what do you know about this case? And you don't want to run the risk that if they say, oh, I heard some wild rumor or another, that now that's contaminated everybody who's in the jury pool.
We are moving through the very slow process here at Circuit Court of picking a jury in this case. The jury selection process went late into the night this evening and will pick back up early tomorrow morning.
A damning email and a love triangle top testimony Wednesday in the George Hughley murder trial.
The George Hughley who walked into the courtroom here about a week ago isn't the same one we've seen in pictures over the past 2 years. And today prosecutors made that very clear.
For the first time, prosecutors are spotlighting how George Hughley's appearance has changed. He's much thinner and much paler than in his 2010 arrest photo.
The jury in the George Hughley murder trial has decided to come back on Wednesday morning to start deliberations after a long and emotional day here at Charlottesville Circuit Court.
A flurry of feet flying in and out of the auxiliary courtroom.
You're running from the front to the back, outside, trying to get a tweet out, but trying not to miss any details at the same time.
Information coming at breakneck speed, keeping reporters on their toes at every moment.
I kind of prefer the old way, but this, I have to admit, there's an added bit of excitement.
Daily Progress reporter Brian McKenzie says he enjoys some of that excitement. But after decades in news, the pressure has never been higher.
Deadline is like now.
But here's the big challenge for reporters and really all media. In order to get the message out, you've got to step out of the courtroom.
And every time someone goes in and out, the metal detector goes beep, 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 which is going to be annoying by the end of the day.
Our NBC 29 web team is doing its part to keep you up to date.
There's a lot of pressure to be able to put out tweets that are accurate and relevant.
So far, the city of Charlottesville and members of the media seem satisfied with the system.
I have talked with the judge. He seems to be pleased with how we're doing in the courtroom, that it's not disruptive.
I think they've done a pretty good job of making sure that we can hear, we can see, and we have some access.
That access ensures we'll continue bringing you the latest as new details unfold. In Charlottesville, I'm Ed Sykes, NBC 29 HD News.
All right, let's check back in with Henry Graff at Charlottesville Circuit Court. Henry?
Yeah, guys, want to give you an update on just some of the things that were happening before the verdict came down and after the verdict came down in terms of emotions, understanding that George Hughley crossed himself in a religious manner before the jury read that verdict out loud. Also learning there was no real emotion from either side as this verdict came down here in Charlottesville Circuit Court this evening here on this day. Also wanted to recap again, George Hughley found guilty of second-degree murder and grand larceny. Also wanted to let you know we are understanding the sentencing phase of this case is now getting underway. They said they need just a short period of time to get up there and get those witnesses together. We also understand that Sharon Love, as I said a little bit earlier, is the first to testify on the stand in this case. She will obviously talk a lot about what Yardley Love meant to her and talk about the impact of Yardley Love's death on her and her family. It has been a very, very tough time for that family throughout the course of this entire more than a year and a half, almost 2 years now, since May of 2010, that they've had to deal with this, and deal with this not only in just a regional sense of it happening here, but with just the microscope, the magnifying glass of the national media covering every single aspect of this case and bringing out every little detail here, that obviously all coming out here in court as Sharon Love takes the stand.
And Henry, as you said, an emotional case for everyone. Yardley Love's family has been here in force, and not so much George Hughley's side, because I know some people have been waiting to be witnesses for this sentencing phase. But in the later days, like today, did George Hughley have more of a support there?
He had what I would say was his normal family and friends support base here today. But as soon as the jury took off to deliberate, they all left very quickly out of the courthouse. Love's family stayed for an extended portion of the morning, left other family members. Her aunt came back at one point just to really check in on things and see how they were going. And shortly before 5 o'clock, Love's family reassembled here at Circuit Court. And then shortly after that, we saw a number of Hughley's family members come back here in court. We've seen both sides go up and down. I would say you did make an accurate observation there. Love's family, friends, supporters have shown out in more force during this entire time than the Hughley side in this case. But again, the support on both sides to go around.
All right, Henry Graff live for us. We will check back in, obviously, with Henry. Lloyd Snook rejoining us here on set, our NBC 29 legal expert. And as we look at the sentencing phase now, obviously this emotional testimony on both sides will have an impact with jurors. What about the fact that the defense, just about from the get-go of this trial, never denied that Hughley played some sort of role in this? Does that have an impact with jurors, even looking back 2 weeks?
Let me state it in sort of the negative side of that. If George Hughley and his defense had stood up and had vigorously defended it and had said George Hughley had nothing to do with this woman's death, this verdict was basically, would have been kicking that in the teeth, would have been saying, nope, we're not buying it, George, forget it. So the fact that he starts from the very beginning saying, yes, this has been a terrible tragedy, yes, this is, you know, I acknowledge I had a role in it, we have to talk about what that role is. At least he gets to come across as saying, I take responsibility for it, and that helps. He doesn't seem as arrogant, as cold, as hard as somebody who had just denied it from the get-go.
Okay, and now we're going to go to Sharon Gregory, who is standing by live tonight outside the court. Hi, Sharon.
Hi, Libby. You know, one of the things that we've talked about is how long this has taken to get to this point. More than a year and a half, nearly 2 years since Yardley Love's badly beaten body was found inside her apartment. At that moment, in May of 2010, investigators went to work, and it's been a long process, not only for the investigators, but also for the lawyers. In the last several months prior to the trial beginning, we've seen a flurry of motions on both sides. Let's take a look back at what got us here to this evening. May 3rd, 2010, the body of UVA lacrosse player Yardley Love is discovered in a pool of blood. Within hours, her ex-boyfriend, lacrosse player George Hughley, is under arrest. One day later, he is charged with her murder. Hughley will go from a life on grounds to a life locked up at the Charlottesville Albemarle Regional Jail.
We are greatly distraught and unsettled to have lost Yardley in such a tragic, violent, and haunting manner.
Please rise for a moment of silence in honor of Miss Love and her family during this difficult time.
In the days after, the UVA community honors Yardley's memory, and out of the tragedy comes change.
Many in this community are still aching from the death of Yardley Love.
August 2010, President Teresa Sullivan welcomes the class of 2014 by announcing a day of dialogue to discuss violence prevention. Fast forward to April 2011, Hughley appears via closed circuit from jail and is formally charged with first-degree murder. Then, a week later, he is indicted for killing Love, and his defense attorneys go to work.
This case is a tragedy, but not about an intentional criminal act.
The judge sets the trial date for February 2012. And of course, that brings us to tonight, and it's been about 2.5 weeks since we began that trial. Again, we are covering this throughout the evening. The sentencing phase has begun. We understand that Sharon Love, Yardley's mom, took the stand, the first one to take the stand this evening. Earlier, the judge said he would push on through until 10 o'clock, but as Henry has reported, that might be a little bit, that might not be enough time because of the witnesses that both the defense and the prosecution say they have to call in this final phase of this trial. Steve Libby.
All right, thanks, Sharon. Live for us tonight.
Mr. Hughley will appeal these convictions.
It's been no secret that George Hughley plans on appealing his second-degree murder conviction and newly imposed 23-year sentence.
He'll appeal his sentence.
And this final sentencing order, just entered, sets the stage for Hughley's appeal to a higher court. With the order in place, his defense team now has 30 days to file a notice of appeal.
Our system provides that a single person or a single group of people are not the final arbiters.
A jury found Hughley guilty in February of killing his ex-girlfriend, Yardley Love, in May 2010. Hughley's attorneys asked Circuit Court Judge Edward Hogshire for a retrial last month. It was denied.
In order to set up your appeal correctly, you need to make sure that you have thoroughly given the judge all of the issues and all of the reasons why the trial ought to be redone.
In this lawsuit filed Thursday in Louisa County Circuit Court, Sharon Love accuses men's lacrosse head coach Dom Starja, assistant coach Mark Van Arsdale, and University Athletics Director Craig Littlepage of negligence and gross negligence in connection with the death of her daughter, Yardley Love. NBC 29 legal analyst Lloyd Snook says it's unusual for a Virginia court to hold a third party liable for someone's killing.
Virginia law says that generally I am not responsible for whatever a third person does, for whatever criminal acts they do, unless I have a special relationship to the victim.
And that phrase, special relationship, is littered all throughout the lawsuit. Court documents point to a series of alcohol-induced incidents where Hughley was not reprimanded by the university. Those incidents include a 2008 public intoxication charge, where an officer had to subdue Hughley with a taser, a 2009 incident where Hughley attacked a fellow teammate, and a spring 2010 incident where Hughley was seen choking Love. Just days later, Hughley murdered her. Back in March, a group of plaintiffs won their case against Virginia Tech following the 2007 shooting massacre. The plaintiffs successfully claimed Tech held a special relationship with the student body. But Sook says what worked then may not work now because each university is governed by different bylaws.
The University of Virginia Board of Visitors, by law, is required to look out for the care and preservation of the property of the University of Virginia. The Board of Visitors of Virginia Tech, by state law, is to look out for the care and preservation of the property, but also the care and the safety of the students. That's part of why there's a special relationship at Virginia Tech. There is no such special relationship at the University of Virginia.
And without that special relationship, Snook says the $29.4 million case will be tough to prove.
Mr. Jefferson's University is filled with bright, promising young people just starting out in life. Until the tragic discovery of Yardley Love's body and the shocking news her ex-boyfriend stood accused, fourth year Valerie Shuping says a lot of students were naive.
Everyone talks about this UVA bubble and how nothing ever bad can happen here.
The crime sent alarms all the way to the top. UVA President Teresa Sullivan set a day of dialogue for students to open up about dating violence. Dean of Students Alan Groves says Hughley's criminal past sparked a change in the school's online self-reporting system.
That Mr. Hughley had an arrest and a police officer had allegedly had to taser him in Lexington. And that's what caused us to take a look at that reporting system.
Groves admits no system is perfect, but believes one tweak is generating valuable information.
So this year we changed the question to say that you haven't already reported using this system, so we're not getting the same thing every year. But we do not do background checks.
UVA Police Officer Angela Tabler has a new title these days. She is now a victim witness coordinator for students who may be in a violent situation.
We accompany
accompany them to court. We assist them with protective orders and just basically outline their resources and let them make the decision from there which way they want to go with it.
Shuping says that's key because students simply don't like to be labeled a snitch.
It could be hard for someone to report a friend or themselves or say that something was happening because everyone around, they don't want to ruin the reputation of themselves or someone else.
It is that silence the university hopes these changes will break through.
All I see is loss.
Charlottesville's Commonwealth's attorney has been at the heart of the case against George Hughley since day one. For Dave Chapman, Yardley Love's murder investigation has been emotional, to say the least. In his first television interview since Hughley was sentenced, Chapman says he has a personal connection to the case.
You know something about where they are in their life, where they might be headed in their life, and you just can recognize for them and for the family and their friends who are close, the overwhelming sadness of their loss.
Chapman says that sadness is what struck him most throughout the case and the 13-day-long trial.
This was no accident.
Chapman believes Hughley meant to hurt her, but not kill her, when he went to talk to Yardley at her apartment. He says that's apparent from Hughley's reaction during his interrogation, when police told Hughley Love died.
I think it's a genuine reaction in many respects.
But Chapman says he doesn't know if the reaction was just the realization Love died or that Hughley was in big trouble.
And he definitely left knowing she had been hurt very badly under the circumstances that he brought about after putting his foot through the bedroom door.
With Hughley now serving a 23-year sentence, Chapman hopes the Love family, Sharon and Lexi, find some sort of happiness and can move forward in life with a huge hole left.
They've set about the business of leaving a positive legacy in the name of a daughter and a sister who would have left one herself had she the opportunity.